The woman with the velvet collar. You say that all the tales of Corsican vendettas are just the same old story over again, Gobert, a retired sea captain, remarked to his friend Captain Michel. Well, you're wrong. I know one story that is so terrible that it makes all the others seem mere child's play. It even sent a chill up my hardened spine. Yes? Michel was sceptical. His was the scepticism of a man who, believing himself to have known the most thrilling adventures, doesn't take stock in other men's tales. Yes, he went on, another case of a couple of bullets in the back, I suppose. But go ahead, let's hear it. We haven't anything better to do. With this last shot, he ordered another round of drinks, and the party of old sea dogs who gathered every evening in the Café of the Sea at Toulon to spin their yarns settled themselves to listen. First of all, Gobert began, my story hasn't anything to do with guns. And secondly, you've never heard of a Corsican vendetta like mine, of course, unless you happen to have been in Bonifacio about 30 years ago as I was. In that case, you would have had your fill of the story because the whole town was agog with it. He looked around inquiringly, but none of the men present had ever touched at Bonifacio during their many voyages. Well, I'm not surprised, Gobert went on. It's not a port of importance, but it is one of the most picturesque towns in Corsica. You've all seen it probably on your way to the Orient, a lovely spot with its old fortress, the turreted battlements, time-stained walls. The fortress juts out over the crags like an eagle's nest. Lay off the descriptions and give us the story, the others exclaimed impatiently. All right, here it is. I was in command of a small destroyer forming part of the squadron escorting the Secretary of the Navy on a tour of inspection at Corsica. At that time they were considering the fortification of several ports. In fact, they even thought for a while of turning Porto Vecchio, which is as large as Brest, into a regular naval base. The Secretary of the Navy went first to Calvi and Bastia, from which we returned to Ajaccio to wait for him while he crossed the island by train, passing by Vizzavona, where he was met with great ceremony by a delegation of bandits who'd left the wilds of the interior that very morning to present their respects to him. The famous Bella Coscia himself commanded the squad that fired the salute. The Secretary of the Navy was much impressed with his imposing bearing, his rifle whose carved stock had a nick in it for every man he killed, and his famous knife, the dagger given to him by Edmond Abou with the request never to leave it in the wound. There you are, the same old stories, Captain Michel interrupted peevishly, just a lot of old wives' tales. You're right, old chap, these are just stories, but if you hold your horses, you'll hear something more important. We left Ajaccio and arrived in Bonifacio at night. The larger ships continued to Porto Vecchio, but I was among those detailed to escort the secretary ashore. It was a gala night. Of course, a big dinner was followed by a grand reception at the town hall. Bonifacio, situated as it was opposite Magdalena, wanted fortifications, and its citizens had turned out in great style to make a good impression. They produced the best of everything they had, flowers, finery, and beautiful women, and you know how beautiful Corsican women can be. At dinner, there were some striking beauties, and I remarked about it enthusiastically to my neighbour, Pietro Santo, a charming fellow of a frank, good-natured appearance, who was then town clerk. Wait until you've seen the woman with the velvet collar, he said seriously in answer to my remark. Is she more beautiful than these? I asked with a smile. Yes, he replied, without smiling. Yes, she is more beautiful, but it's not the same kind of beauty. In the meantime, our conversation drifted to the customs of the country. My head was still ringing with all the brigand stories I'd just been hearing from my comrades on their return from escorting the secretary to Vizzavona, and their account of the spectacular reception by Bella Coscia had seemed to me like a scene from a musical comedy. I thought it was rather polite on my part to doubt the dangerous character of these outlaws. After all, Corsica was civilized and certain parts of France itself at that time. The custom of the vendetta, Santo explained to me after I had spoken, continues to be part of the code of honour here in the same way that duelling is with you. Your revenge accomplished, you automatically find yourself an outlaw. But what can be done about it? It's too bad, of course, but we have to put up with existing facts. I myself am an easygoing man. I was brought up in an antique dealer's shop, and I'm sorry to see how savage some of my compatriots can still be when their family honour, as they call it, is in danger. "You surprise me," I exclaimed, pointing out to him the jolly, good-natured faces around the banqueting table. He shook his head. "Don't trust them," he warned, and his face grew dark. A laugh changes very quickly to a diabolical grin on their lips. "All these dark eyes are sparkling with frankness and merriment tonight. Tomorrow they may flash black with thoughts of hate and revenge, and all those slender, delicate hands clasping each other in good fellowship will never cease toying with hidden arms." "I thought these customs had died out in the cities and only existed in the little villages of the interior," I said. "The first husband of the lady with the velvet collar was mayor of Bonifacio, sir." I didn't understand the allusion, and I was on the verge of asking for an explanation of this somewhat enigmatical remark when I was stopped by a call for silence. The speeches were about to begin. At their conclusion, we withdrew into the drawing room, and it was there that I first saw the woman with the velvet collar. Nor did I need Pietro Santo to point it out to me. There was no mistaking the strange, funereal beauty and the velvet ribbon which circled the base of her neck, making a wide, black strip against the whiteness of her skin. This velvet collar was worn very low at the rise of the shoulders and emphasized her long and slender neck. She carried her head very proudly, always holding it in a straight, upright position. Her face was classic in its beauty, but so pale that one would have believed it chiseled in marble had it not been for the two flashing eyes of strange brilliancy. As she passed through the room, they all bowed to her with lowered eyes, and I caught a general atmosphere of fear and instinctive recoil which aroused my curiosity to full pitch. Her beautiful body was draped in black velvet, and as she came forward, slipping in and out of the crowd with her proud head and tragically pale face, I had the impression of seeing the dignified ghost of some dead and martyred queen. When she'd gone, I turned to my new friend and voiced my feelings about this uncanny woman. "There's nothing strange about that," he answered seriously. "She was guillotined." I looked at him in astonishment. What do you mean?" I stammered. But he couldn't answer me immediately. The woman with the velvet band, having greeted the Secretary of the Navy, came down the room towards us, stopped, and held out her hand to my friend. "Good evening, Pietro Santo," she said, and I noticed that her head never moved from its rigid position. He mumbled something and bowed, and she went on. All the eyes of the room were focused on her, and a deep silence had fallen. I noticed then that she was escorted by a handsome, well-built fellow of about 30. His face had the fine profile often found on old Greek coins. These delicate features are frequently seen among the Corsicans, and sometimes give them a family resemblance with the great emperor. "He's her second husband," Pietro Santo whispered, noticing my gaze. The couple disappeared at this moment, and I was conscious of a sigh of relief rising throughout the room, while an old man in the corner crossed himself, muttering a prayer. "They never stay very long," Pietro Santo explained, "because they're not on very good terms with the present mayor, Ascoli. Angelucia, that's her name, has always been proud and ambitious, and she wanted her second husband, Giuseppe Giugenti, to be mayor like her first one. But they were defeated at the last elections, and I think they always will be, because of the guillotine affair." I started and caught my friend by the arm. He smiled. "Oh," he exclaimed, "you like to know the story. I hear the mayor telling it to the secretary this minute, but he doesn't know it as well as I do. You see, Captain, I was a member of the household, and I saw everything, even to the bottom of the basket." "Have a cigar, Santo," I offered. "You've never smoked any as good as these." Pietro Santo took a cigar, and I fumed with impatience while he chatted with the man who'd interrupted us. Afterwards, I suggested he came aboard my ship, for I was determined to know the rest of the story before I left Bonifacio. "And so," I began with a laugh as soon as we were installed in my cabin, "you say that the woman was guillotined?" "You do wrong to laugh, sir," he replied, extremely serious. "She was guillotined, and it happened before the eyes of almost all the people you saw this evening. If you noticed, they all crossed themselves when she came into the room." I stared at him in open-eyed amazement, and he went on simply, "That's why she always wears that velvet band to hide the scar. Mr. Santa, you're making fun of me. I'm going to call on Angelucci myself and ask her to take the band off before my eyes. I should like to see that scar. The man shook his head. She wouldn't take it off, sir. We all know that if she did, her head would fall off. And so saying, he too made the sign of the cross. I studied him by the light of the little swinging lamp. With his curly hair and slight figure, he looked like a timid angel frightened at the sight of the devil. I couldn't help smiling. And yet, Antonio Macchi, Angelucci's first husband, was the best of men, he sighed. Who would ever suspect such a thing of him? I loved him, sir. He'd been very good to me. He was an antique dealer, and he brought me up in his shop. He was famous all through Corsica, and known to many tourists, to whom he sold souvenirs of Napoleon and the imperial family. He manufactured these curios, because the rage for them was such that the authentic pieces had long ago been sold, and there were no more to be had. He made a fortune in this business, and tourists were quite happy with their purchases, which they were firmly convinced were authentic. Antonio, however, never lost an opportunity to buy any revolutionary articles when the occasion offered. He was able to sell them at a good price to the English and the Americans, who never left the island without first paying him a little visit. From time to time he made short trips to France to renew our stock, and I went with him the last time he went to Toulon. He'd read in the papers that there were some very interesting pieces to be sold at auction, and he was anxious to acquire them for his shop. We made a number of purchases that day. We bought a Bastille relief for 425 francs, General Moreau's bed for 215 francs, Mirabeau's death mask for 1,000 francs, a bezel ring with some locks of Louis XVI's hair for 1,200 francs, and last, the famous guillotine, which it seems Samson himself, the famous executioner, had used. This cost us 921 francs. And we returned home, very well pleased with ourselves and our purchases. We found Andalucia and her cousin Giuseppe waiting for us on the dock. The deputy mayor and a delegation from the town council were also waiting for us because Antonio, through his successful business, had become one of the most important men in the town and had been elected mayor. He was about 40 years old at the time, and his wife 20. But this great difference in age didn't keep Angelucia from loving her husband ardently. Giuseppe, however, who was about her age, obviously adored his cousin. Anyone could see it merely by the manner in which he looked at her. But be that as it may, I must add that for my part I'd never seen anything in the behaviour of the two to justify the slightest suspicion in the husband. Angelucia herself was too honest and too upright in her actions to give poor Giuseppe any chance to forget her marital duties. And I never believed that he would have had the daring to attempt such an enterprise. He loved Andalucia, that was all. And my master knew it as well as the rest of us. Perfectly sure of his wife, he used to joke with her sometimes about it. Angelucia, who was kind by nature, asked him to spare her poor cousin and not make too much fun of him, because Antonio would never find his equal in imitating and redoing furniture of the Empire and Louis XVI. Giuseppe, in fact, was a real artist. Besides, he knew all of Antonio's business secrets, which was probably why the dealer tolerated a workman who looked at his wife with such eloquent eyes. Giuseppe's forlorn love made him rather melancholy, but Angelucia was always gay. She hadn't yet become the funereal beauty you saw today. She laughed often, was an affectionate and happy with her husband, like any good little wife who has nothing on her conscience. Our return was well celebrated. Angelucia had prepared an excellent luncheon and had invited a few friends to share it with us. Everyone was anxious to hear of the new and sensational purchases, and everyone wanted to see them. "Does the guillotine still work?" one of the guests asked. "Would you like to try it?" the master of the house answered with a laugh. During the meal, Antonio, next to whom I was seated, accidentally dropped his napkin and bent over to pick it up. But I had already seen it slide to the floor, and my head was under the table at the same time as his was. I straightened up and returned him his napkin. Then, with a hurried excuse, I left the room bewildered. I stumbled into the shop, and I sank back into a chair. My discovery had momentarily stunned me, but as my wits returned to me, my first question was, had Antonio seen? No. My sudden movement and the position of my head under the table must have made that impossible. Besides, the very calmness with which he had straightened up and received the napkin from me, and the quiet way in which he resumed conversation, should have reassured me. I returned to the dining room, where the meal was finishing gaily. The deputy mayor, who is the mayor today, was insisting on being shown the guillotine immediately. Antonio, however, answered that he must wait until the instrument of death had been put in working order. "I know my Americans," he added with a laugh. "They won't buy it unless it works perfectly." Shortly afterwards, the guests took leave of their hosts, and during the rest of the day I couldn't keep my eyes off Angelucia, who kissed her husband 100 times if she kissed him once during the afternoon. It made me shiver to watch her. I did not imagine that such deceit was possible in so young and apparently frank a person. "You see, Captain, when I bent under the table at luncheon, I had seen Angelucia's little foot tightly and amorously pressed between Giuseppe's. Her very movement in releasing her foot had proved the crime to me." As the days passed, life at the shop went on as usual. A few foreign customers came for the famous guillotine, but the master answered there were still some necessary repairs and that he would not sell it until it was in perfect working condition. In fact, we were working on it secretly in the basement and had taken it down and put it together several times. It was badly worm-eaten and out of joint, and we were trying to balance it properly so that the knife would run smoothly in its grooves. The work revolted me, but it seemed on the contrary to please Antonio. Angelucia's birthday and the Pentecost fell on the same date, and as it was customary for the mayor to give a party of some sort on the day of Pentecost, Antonio announced that he had decided to give a costume ball. This will be an excellent opportunity to show his guillotine. No one had seen it yet, and it was to be the crowning event of the evening. Bonifacio is very fond of this kind of amusement, historical reconstructions and pageants. And when Andalucia heard the plan, she flung herself on her husband's neck like a happy child. She herself suggested that she go as Marie Antoinette. "We'll make it very realistic and guillotine you at the end of the party," Antonio said with a laugh. "Why not?" Angelucia answered. "It would be fun." When the town knew what sort of a party the mayor was planning, everyone wanted to go, and the next 15 days before Pentecost were filled with preparations. The shop was full from morning till night, with people running in and out, asking advice and studying old prints. Antonio was to represent Fouquier Tinville, the terrible public accuser. Giuseppe was to be Samson, the executioner, and I was to fill the humble role of his aide. The great day arrived. Early in the morning, we emptied the shop of all the odds and ends with which it was filled, and we put up the guillotine. Giuseppe had made a knife of cardboard covered with silver paper, so that Angelucia's desire to play the guillotine scene to the end could be carried out, and we tried the machine several times to make sure it worked. We danced all afternoon, and at night there was a big ball at the town hall. Everyone drank toast after toast enthusiastically to the mayor and his beautiful wife. Angelucia was dressed in the costume worn by Marie Antoinette during her imprisonment, and this simple dress, well in keeping with the feelings of a poor woman destined for so tragic an end, suited her marvellously. I shall never forget the sight of Angelucia's beautiful white neck rising proudly from the delicately crossed kerchief. And Giuseppe devoured her with his eyes. Catching the too apparent flame of desire in his look, I couldn't help glancing from time to time at Antonio, who seemed almost wildly gay. At the end of the dinner, it was he who gave the signal for the start of the horrible play. In a well-prepared speech, he informed the guests that he and some friends of his had planned a little surprise, which consisted in presenting to them the most tragic hours of the revolution. Bonifacio having the great fortune of possessing a guillotine, they were going to make use of it to decapitate Marie Antoinette. At these words, all the people laughed and cheered, giving a merry ovation to Andalucia, who rose from her seat and declared that she would know how to die courageously as befitted a queen of France. A roll of drums suddenly beat in the streets and we ran to the windows. A miserable cart drawn by a dilapidated horse stood there, surrounded by guards and officers of the guillotine, all wearing the bonnet of the revolution. A group of horrible knitting women danced and sang in the streets, calling loudly for the death of the Austrian dethroned Queen of France. One might very easily have imagined oneself back in the days of 1793. We'd all taken part in his game without seeing any harm in it, and it wasn't until Angelucia had stepped into the cart with her hands tied behind her back and the procession had started to the sinister beat of her funeral drums that more than one felt a shiver steal up his spine and realise that such a masquerade might well touch upon sacrilege. The whole scene was horribly effective. Night had fallen, and the flickering light of the torches gave a death-like beauty to Andalucia's face, and she played her part well. Holding herself proudly erect, she seemed to be braving the populace with her cold stare, and her face, with its changeless severity of expression, might well have been carved in stone. We reached Antonio's house, and there the gay laughs broke out anew. Antonio was already in the shop, where he'd seated a chosen group of people who were to watch the mock execution. The mob was thickly packed in, and everyone was in a state of extreme excitement at finally seeing the famous guillotine at such close range. My master asked for silence and began by making a little speech on the good points of the instrument of death. He mentioned all the noble necks which he claimed had rested on the headboards, and he ended by exhibiting the real knife which he bought at the same time. "I had the paper knife up there made so that you could see just how the thing worked," he explained, and then turning to Giuseppe, "Are you ready, Samson?" Samson replied that he was ready. "Bring forth the Austrian," Antonio ordered in a deep voice. Giuseppe and I placed Marie Antoinette and Angelucia on the plank, and Antonio himself lowered the board that held the head in position. The laughter in the room suddenly ceased, and an uneasy feeling swept over the crowd. The sight of the lovely body stretched out on the plank brought to the minds of even the hardened men present the memory of all the unfortunates who had really lain there to die. The joke had been carried too far. The merriment was revived for the moment, however, by the sight of Angelucia's amused face as she looked there and here at the guests while her husband finished his lecture on the machine, showing the basket which received the body and into which the head fell. But suddenly, as we watched Angelucia, an awful change came over her face. Wild terror was written there. Her eyes had widened horribly, and her mouth opened as though to let out a cry which stuck in her throat. Giuseppe was at the back and had seen nothing of this, but I, who was at the side, was struck with a nameless fear, as the others had been. We were looking at the sight of one who really knew she was going to be decapitated. The laughter had died out, and some of the people even shrank back as though struck by an invincible terror. As for me, I came closer, for I had suddenly noticed that Angelucia's horror-stricken eyes were staring at something in the bottom of the basket which was to receive the head. I looked into this basket, which Antonio had opened only a moment before, and I too read what Angelucia had read. I too read the little placard fastened to the bottom. "Pray to the Virgin Mary, Angelucia, wife of Antonio, mistress of Giuseppe, for you are about to die." I uttered a hollow cry and turned like a madman to stop Giuseppe, who at a motion from Antonio had seized the rope. Alas, I was too late. The knife fell, and what followed was horrible, too horrible for words. The unfortunate woman let out a scream which ended in an abrupt gurgle, a scream which will echo in my ears to my dying day, and then her blood spouted out over the audience, who let out sickening cries and made a desperate fight for the door. I fainted. Here Pietro Santo stopped and grew so pale at the memory of the awful scene that I feared he was going to be ill. I restored some of his strength with a glass of old grappa. "But in spite of all that," I said to him, "Angelucia was not killed. I saw her myself, and she certainly was alive." He sighed and he lifted his head. "Are you really sure she is alive?" he asked. "There isn't a soul in Bonifacio who passes her in the street without crossing himself. Seeing her never look to the right nor to the left, always holding her head rigid, they firmly believe that her head is held to her neck by some supernatural miracle. That is how the legend of the velvet collar grew. Besides, she looks like a ghost, and when she shakes hands with me, the touch of her icy skin makes me tremble." "Yes, I know it's childish, but the whole affair was such a strange one. You must excuse the fantastic tales which our peasant folk have created. The truth of the matter is, I suppose, that Antonio planned his blow badly, that the machine was too old and didn't work properly, and that Angelucia's head was pushed too far through the opening in such a way that the knife struck her at the rise of the shoulders. This is not the first time that such an accident has occurred with the guillotine. We have heard of cases where it took 5 tries to cut the head off. Giuseppe was the only one present when the doctor, whom he himself had fetched, saw her, and he says that the wound was quite large. Everybody ran away at the time, and Antonio himself disappeared. You can see how all this helped form the legend that grew up overnight. Even those who were present at the time claim that they saw Angelucia's head actually drop into the basket. Naturally, when Angelucia reappeared some weeks later with the velvet ribbon, imaginations ran riot. And even when I look at her, there are times when I'm hypnotized by her neck and wouldn't dare, under any circumstances, untie her velvet band. And what happened to Antonio? He's dead. Or at least, so they say. At any rate, his decease has been legally published since Giuseppe and Angelucia are married. They found his body half-eaten by crabs on the beach near the grottos. The corpse was completely disfigured, but they found papers on it, and the clothes were his. He probably ran away, believing Angelucia dead, and threw himself over the cliff. He had prepared his revenge well, silently and cunningly, as they do here. But I'm still amazed at the skill with which he hid his feelings from the day when he first got an inkling of the truth of the relations between Angelucia and her cousin. The police have duplicate knife that he made so that it would look like Giuseppe's. It's in Ajaccio. Yeah, your story isn't bad, Captain Michel conceded generously to Gobert. It has an element of horror in it. No, it's not finished yet, Gobert explained, asking for another few minutes of silence. Let me go on and you will see that it really is horrible. I didn't know the end myself until some time later on a second voyage to Bonifacio, and it was good to see El Pietro Santo, who related the concluding details to me. Imagine my extreme amazement when, on asking him the news of the woman with the velvet collar, he answered me in perfect seriousness, Captain, the legend was right after all. Angelucia died on the day that the velvet collar was touched. What? I cried, but who undid the collar? I did. And her head fell off. While I stared at Pietro Santo, wondering if he'd lost his mind, he explained to me that after I'd left Bonifacio, a doubt had spread through the town as to the truth of Antonio's supposed death. It seemed that Ascoli, the mayor, was responsible for this and claimed to know what he was talking about. He was convinced that he had met Antonio one day when he was out hunting. The man had been almost naked, living like a wild beast, and when Ascoli tried to speak to him, he ran away. It was during this time that the elections for mayor came up again and Giuseppe was Ascoli's rival for the post. During the entire campaign, Ascoli declared that Giuseppe was the accomplice of a bigamous woman and therefore unworthy of the position. Giuseppe's rage knew no bounds when he was defeated and he resolved to hunt Antonio out. It took him several months to do so, but he finally accomplished his purpose. Antonio, who for 10 years had never spoken to a soul, learned that his wife was not dead as he had supposed, but was living happily with Giuseppe in the very house in which he had been mayor and had believed himself loved by her. What happened then, Pietro Santo went on in a hollow voice, is beyond conception, and would make even the demons in hell shrink in horror. Good Lord, if I live to be 1,000... But to cut it short, sir, the story can be told in a few words. One evening, a soft, clear evening like this, I was returning from an expedition to the grottos, where I had escorted some friends, and I was seated in the little boat taking us back to port, when, in passing the cliffs, I heard a chant that made my blood run cold. It was the song which is always sung here by those who have some mortal affront to avenge. I lifted my head. A man stood like a statue on the edge of the rocks, which served as a sort of pedestal to him. Although he was dressed in rags, he shouldered his gun proudly, and suddenly, as the last rays of the sun caught his face and brought it into full relief, I uttered one cry, Antonio! It was he, it was he. Oh, I was sure it was he. His fatal song and exalted air convinced me that he had not returned to these parts after playing dead for 10 years without nursing some abominable purpose. Fortunately, I could reach town quicker by boat than he could on foot. There will be time to warn Giuseppe and Ada Lucia. I threw myself on the oars and I reached the dock in a few minutes. The first person I met was Giuseppe himself, who was on his way home from the town hall. I thanked heaven that I'd arrived in time and called out to him to hurry, that a terrible misfortune was about to fall, that I had seen Antonio, Antonio himself, alive, and that he was on his way to town. While questioning me, he fell into step beside me, and we both ran for the house at full speed and arrived there panting. "Ada Lucia! Ada Lucia!" we called, flinging open the door. No answer. "God help us if she's gone for a walk," Giuseppe groaned desperately. We went upstairs, still calling her, and he went into one room while I entered another, and it was there that I found her. She was seated by the window in a large armchair, her head resting against the cushion, and she seemed to be sleeping. As she was always extremely pale, the pallor of her beautiful face didn't surprise me, although it might have struck another. "Come," I cried to Giuseppe, "she's here." In the meantime, I had come closer, surprised that she didn't awake. I touched her. I touched the velvet band, which came loose in my hands, and her head rolled off. I fled with my heart pounding wildly from shock and fright, but on my way I slipped and fell in a horrible pool of blood, which I hadn't noticed on entering because of the shadows which darkened the room. I picked myself up with a yell and left the house madly. People ran from me in the streets as one runs from a wild beast. During the next few days, I came near to going insane. Fortunately, I completely recovered my senses well enough, in fact, to be the present mayor of Bonifacio. As you probably understand by now, sir, I had seen Antonio as he was returning from the deed. It was easy enough to figure the whole thing out. Then he'd entered the house. He'd found Ada Lucia alone, and he'd killed her with a stab to the heart. Then, his mind haunted by what Ascoli had told him, he completed the work which he'd commenced so clumsily 10 years before. More certain of his Corsican dagger than of the mock historical instrument which had failed him before, he had decapitated her, and without shrinking from the atrocity of the deed, had replaced her head on her shoulders and had it tied in position with the velvet ribbon. "And now," concluded Pietro Santo, "if you want news of Giuseppe, you will have to go into the wilds for it. 2 days after the murder, he disappeared into the mountains with a gun over his shoulder and Ada Lucia's head, which he'd embalmed himself in a sack round his waist. Giuseppe, Ascoli, and Antonio have never been seen since, but they have probably met in the approved fashion and killed each other in some hidden corner of the woods. That, sir, is the only way in which the custom of vendetta will be done away with in this country, when everybody is dead."